them reach up to the point where men are, because women are not as exposed as men due to cultural differences and also if you compare Africa with developed nations, women have better opportunities, although also they are not as empowered as the men. For us in Africa, what we need is education, opportunities, giving them the opportunities that are given to men. We need legislations that are sustainable, that will give women the opportunity to reach the height men have reached. Because if women are given opportunity, I'm proud to say they do better than men. Not because I'm a woman. They should, even in trade, most of our informal trade all over the world are done by women. Even this border that is closed now, I'm sure the people hurting more are the women are in small scale industries and SMEs. If you compare Africa with the international countries, you can't say we compare Africa because those are developed economies. We are still trying to develop it. The legislators, there are strong legislation that back women issues so that women can come on the table and play with the men. If there are not strong legislation, we'll always be at the back door. And also, while women are not too strong, I would take for example in Nigeria, most of the meetings are done at night, 2 a.m., 3 a.m. Tell me which woman will be leaving her husband or her house at 3 a.m. to go for negotiations. Although the woman will have a clear mandate, the society will, will call her, in quotes, a walkabout. You know what I mean? Yes, but it's not so. We need strong legislation to help women achieve. And also, the women we elect in the national assemblies should also protect other women. I have never heard them come strong on issues that affect women. We need them to be strong advocates of women issues. We are the soft agenda, yes, of course, but we are lawyers in the boardroom, if given the opportunity. And the countries that have really tried that can compare with international community are countries like Rwanda, who has done very good in putting women in governance, in Ethiopia, in Kenya, in Uganda, even in Senegal and Nepal. But in Nigeria, our dear country, we still have a long way to go. We are pushing, but we'll reach there. And I hope by 2023, which is the next election, right, this will have been better for us women.
Thank you, Your Excellency. I'll get back to you with another question. That is a very good transition for me to ask Her Excellency, Dr. Fatoumatou, who was a former speaker of the Gambian Parliament, but also she was deputy speaker of the ECOWAS and has extensive experience in politics, but at the same time, she's leading an NGO advocating for the rights of women. They always say that there is no political participation without economic empowerment. Can you tell us your experience about that?
That is true. And like I said earlier, day before yesterday, when I did my maiden speech here, I said, listen, we are in Nigeria, so we are going to take Nigeria as the case study to build Africa we want, economically, politically, socially, even culturally, because we just had a session here. And all the sessions were wonderful. When the bankers came, I thought it was the best. The energy people, I learned a lot. from the energy. And then the entertainment industry came, I thought it's the best. Now we have the women, the legislation yesterday, which is very important because you cannot do anything without laws. So when we take a case study of Nigeria and we look at the statistics, in fact, before I say the statistics, I'm very comfortable to say what I'm going to say here, which is my mind and my thoughts and my own perspective of how I want the Africa we are building based on economy and across the board sector from this meeting. That today, in this hall, when I catch my, as a trade journalist, we are trained to count crowds. When they say there were over 100,000 people, you know that sometimes it's true because you can count with your eyes. So while sitting down, I counted that we have more men in this hall right now. We are discussing women. So we are very comfortable because we are talking to them. Because they should listen to us. And on this panel, we have a he/she. And the chairman is also a he/she. And most of Ms. Nancy's board members are also he/she. So we are very comfortable. And this is one of the most important panel discussion. And I hope at the end of the day, the general report tour will capture the participation of women here. Coming back to what I was saying, if you look at the statistics, it's telling us. It might be true, it might not be true, but at least it's always 10% below or over. 50%, Nigeria is ranking below 50% for gender equality. That's a serious thing, because we all look at Nigeria. It is the big brother of Africa, whether we like it or not. It's the biggest economy, it's mighty. Nigeria, if anything, is super extra extra. So when you have that, we should, you know, look from you. So if we have that, there should be a mind change set from Nigeria to accept women coming in to participate in politics, in the legislation, in the lower local government. We call them local government and lower election, lower councils, in the local government. I don't know whether there is even a chairwoman in one of your local governments. I remember when I was deputy speaker, one of the senators, I think it was Mabu from Abia State, when I used to chair and control them, they said, "No, you used to talk, what local government is bigger than Gambia?" It is true. It is true. Because we are a population not more than 2 million. When you have a local government here, which is 3 million or 4 million. So if we have women as chairpersons and local councillors, we can learn from there because we are better managers. Take it from whether you like it or not. I mean, God has given it to us. When we carried for 9 months, you are not there. And we carried on. We is out. Imagine that warm breastfeed you are, the mom is having the eye contact with the baby. And what is coming out. That's why even Europeans are now saying they are recommending to give the baby breastfeed babies for 6 months without water. So that warmness, you know, the mother is the first teacher. So she was talking about education, which is also very important, that we women are to be educated to alleviate that, which is one part of our subject, to alleviate poverty alleviation. Because if we are not educated through the normal system or skills, then we cannot participate. We have to participate in order for democracy to be stable in Africa, women's participation has to come. And from my experience, it's not like we are always saying, yes, Rwanda, some people are saying Rwanda has the highest percentage of women. But when you have clever men, they will tell you, oh, they kill all the men during the war. That's why you have more women's beer now. So, okay, let's forget about that and say, okay, we have women. Let's do like Rwanda, go to Europe, like Sweden, like Norway. And I cannot see why in Nigeria, a parliament of over 300, you only have 20 women. It has to stop. And this AEC is going to stop it.
Yes.
That the next election we are seeing in Nigeria, we are going to have women senators, women parliamentarians, and women presidents, not even a running man, let the running man be a man. Women governors, and let the running man be a man. So that we can continue as this. But the that's where the pink waves. The pink waves have to turn now to blue waves. And that's where I saw
it. Thank you. I think here we need a man contribution. And Your Excellency, you put up a campaign He for She. It's a very interesting campaign. We need the focusing, we need campaigning, we need the participation of men, because most of the programs that are designed for women empowerment only include women. We need to change this rhetoric. So could you tell us your experience for the campaign, and what are the key criteria that programs designed for women should do to include, to be more inclusive, to promote gender equality?
Thank you. I congratulate the African Agency Congress, congratulate you and your team. I equally find this as an honor to be amongst very distinguished people. I always admire women who take the bull by the horn and they eventually make a reasonable big pass. But there's a question I have to ask now. We have a NAFTAC. Where is Dora Akinyele in the NAFTAC? That was an impartial. Today we have registered pharmaceutical drugs that are safe for us to consume. That's an initiative from a woman. And that was Dora Akinyele. She may not be here today, but that's an impact. When you bring a woman into the managerial position, certainly you expect to get the best. And that's what we are saying. With Nigeria today, I'm not addressing from your question. The Nigeria of today, if you have women managing key sensitive positions around the economic sector, we're going to have a push. We're going to move forward. We're going to have a leapfrog forward as a country. That aside, from the question we have, I travel around the world, internationally. You have women that respect the status which they have as women. They equally engage the men constructively, but at the same time not losing the sight and the fact that, yes, they have something to bargain with. What they have to bargain with is the fact that they are female gender, right? But at the same time, it's the responsibility of the men. That's why you have the United Nations He for She campaign, to ensure that gender equality. What is gender equality? Excellency, the former Speaker of the Gambia, respectively, had talked about the misadventure of women in the last political dispensation, or this current political dispensation. 20 women in the Nigerian parliament. It does not tell good of the fact that the men are not giving them the space, but there has to be an engagement which women have to constructively come up with within the African context. This is an African matter. The cultural issues should be put on the side. The bias should be put on the side. We should take responsibility and give women their rightful place. When we do that, we have a leapfrog forward. Let me digress a little to the economic side. Now, if indeed you say you are measuring how much impact you have in development, the first index that you have to look at is how many girl child are in school. What's the proportion? Is this money low? Is less than 20% of school enrollment. That's not encouraging. So what is it that we are supposed to take home in Africa is that we should encourage the girl child. When we encourage the girl child, we encourage the nation. When we encourage the nation, we leap forward as a continent. When we leap forward as a continent, we're a reference point and a global frame. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Women access to senior position is a very, very important issue that both women and men have advocated for in the African continent for many years. Mrs. Tosin Dombsby, you are only in 2 senior positions. Congratulations for that. My question here is, do you think that we're doing enough to promote women's access to senior position, whether at the political level or at the business level? And do you think it is not high time for Africa to develop policies that could, gender-sensitive policies that could be institutionalized within the administration, that could be part of these organizational culture, and that they have to apply these policies based on human rights and not because they are obliged by the law.
Thank you very much. Are women doing enough, giving women the opportunity, the exposure they need? I would say we are trying. Maybe I'll just make reference to the politics they talked about. During the campaign, after the elections, there was a program that was organized for women who participated in the elections, and different questions came up. And we, myself and my colleague, she runs a women radio in Lagos. We could count how many women came on our stations to come and talk about their policies, about their agenda, what they had to offer for people to vote for them. And when we asked why they didn't come, they said they didn't have the money. But some events were held where my company, we told them that any woman that was ready to come on AIT will be taken free of charge. And only few of them took advantage of that opportunity to come and talk about what they had to offer. And I know of other stations too who gave them the platform to come, but just a few come. So talking about educating the girl child, I think it also starts from education. If they go to school, they are educated, they're bold enough to compete with their male counterpart. Now, some of these women actually had the fear of coming on TV. What were they going to talk about? So before I decide I want to participate in politics, I want to come out to offer myself to my people, I must know what it is I have to offer them, so that anywhere I go and they're asking me the question, I know what I have to offer the people. So I also believe, yes, the women have been given the opportunity, but some of them are actually not taking advantage of it because of the fear of what am I really going to offer the people. We've suggested that before the next election, let the women come together. Let's look at it. What are the things that are missing? What are the people looking for? And let's all work together and agree that, yes, anytime any one of them is asked to come out, they know what it is they're coming to talk about. Also talking about positions, we'll try to follow up. Yes, so a lot of them did not get the elected positions, but then the government is in place now and they have opportunities to appoint people into different positions, commissioners, special advisors. I think it's only one state that had more women than men as commissioners, and I think that is Kwara State. All others, maybe you have just one woman and 30 men. Two women, 40 men. So what are we doing about this? Why are these men not putting these women in this position? Is it that they're not available or they cannot perform this role that that they need to be put into? I do not think so. As women, we need to, she said it too, that the men are here, they're the ones that need to listen. Why are you not putting women in some of these positions? We have women all over the world doing a lot of fantastic things. Even in Nigeria, they are doing it. So we as women, I think there's a lot for us to do to make sure that the women we are also putting in, but some of them have argued that some they have put there never performed up to expectation. So we also need to know the women we are presenting, we are appointing to represent us as women in some of these positions that are available for us to be filled in.
This is Nikeshi. Well, today we talk a lot about female entrepreneurship and its important relations to promote growth. You have quite a few years of experience in providing expertise and experience in coaching female entrepreneurs. Could you tell us a little bit about your experience in terms of that?
Thank you very much. I work for a company called Ventures Park, and it's a subsidiary of Ventures Platform. And we've been in operation for 3 years. And in that time, we funded about 32 entrepreneurs, 32 founders. we're very deliberate in finding and funding female entrepreneurs as well. We knew that if we didn't add some deliberateness to that, we would default and end up with mainly men on our portfolio. And I'll tell you that despite being so deliberate, we still have mainly men on our portfolio. And when we check the success rate of the founders that we funded, the men are doing better than the women. So we started building capacity for entrepreneurs, especially women, trying to see where are the gaps and how can we be more deliberate in helping them achieve more. Because we've even noticed that when it comes to accessing funds and financing, women access less funds than men. So already they are at a disadvantage of building a successful business. Now, there's a social experiment that a gentleman ran recently, and to bring it to my point, he wanted to recruit for a position in his company, and it was the same job description, the same everything, but just one difference. In one, he put a chief of staff, and the other one, he put an executive assistant. So many men apply for the chief of staff, and so many women apply for the executive assistant. Same, everything about the job was exactly the same. And that shows the way women even perceive themselves. They don't feel that they are worthy of certain things, or this particular box that they created is not for them. And in entrepreneurship, especially for our space where it's very tech heavy, where we're looking at innovation and entrepreneurship and being able to bring new and sustainable solutions, it's very male dominated. It's really male dominated, but we're seeing some advancements, we're seeing some progress, because we did a survey recently and we discovered that women might not be CEOs of these tech enterprises, but we're now seeing them in as CFOs or CTOs, and there's progress that is being made, and for us we're still being more deliberate. But I will say this, it is not for the men to create positions for us, it's not for them to invite us to the table. It's for us to understand that we need to be deliberate about it ourselves. So and for women that are doing business, even when they try to pitch their business, they are trying to be humble about it, and they make their business sound like a side hobby. No one wants to invest in a side hobby. But for the men, they are more audacious about it, even with the little achievements. So for women, we need to step up in ourselves, and we need to be able to support ourselves as well.
Thank you for with some motivation. We'll come to the last questions. Mrs. Nancy, you're a very important media professional, and also you are very engaged in the development of Africa. And I would say that not all media professionals are engaged in the development, because we do not foresee media as a development partner. What, in your opinion, the measures to and the steps that we need to do to mobilize media and work with the media as a development partner, not as a medium to cover development programs?
Thank you, Karima. excuse me, everyone. That's quite an important question. And in the course of organizing this, at least for the past few months now, I've had that reflection to ask myself, would it be right for me to call myself a journalist anymore? Why? Because it seems perhaps, if we take the case study of Nigeria, our role as media professionals are enshrined in the Constitution. They do call us as the first estate of the realm. But like you said, we should, as media professionals, go beyond now reportage, or they're having an event, they call us to cover. So people just see us as agents of publicity. Can we now become agents of change and agents of development? So in the last few months of planning this, I would say I'm not comfortable anymore to be called a journalist. And perhaps, if you want to perhaps address me, and you still want to stick with journalists, stick with, I'm a development journalist. Why? Because I want to see change. And if I'm not seeing the change, I'm enforcing the change because I also have power to follow through on the change. So I think as women, especially even in Nigeria, and I do think even in my space, the media space, we see a lot of women that are broadcasters. Tosin Dokpesi is a woman. She's the managing director of Africa Independent Television, the foremost private station in Africa. And she's a woman. And I would also say even working with her, because I work with her closely, when you now talk about giving women opportunities, it's a no-brainer that we should give women opportunities. Like I always say, empowering the woman is smart economics. It's just smart. And it's a smart business case. But we just really need to start from education. And we really also need to, for those of us that are women in spaces of influence, in spaces of development, we also need to do more to lift other women deliberately. In what I'm doing as a media professional, I'm finding myself in the space which I find myself. I am a journalist, or I'm a broadcaster, or I'm a development journalist right now. I'm in the space that they think is for men. How can you have a woman talking about business or economy, especially in Africa, which we do not see? We see the men go for hard things, hard numbers. How are you able to inculcate this and come out strong and you know, enforce yourself and people believe you? I also do think that for me in my space, that I've been doing this for quite some time now, I also realize it is important to lift not just other people, but lift other women. I have a lot of young people that I'm mentoring, a lot of young girls working with me that I've seen grow, even doing this that I'm doing, and also men. So there is that importance that we should be able to create spaces for those of us that have areas of influence.
Thank you so much. I think one key important concept that we heard here is development journalists. This is quite important. And even now, at the level of providing education and expertise, there is what we call development outreach specialists that are communication specialists that bridge the gap between the technical development specialist and, you know, the citizens. So I think this is something that we have to note to bridge the gap between the different stakeholders to promote gender equality in Africa. If I want to ask you my last questions, what are the two key recommendations that you would provide us to promote gender equality in Africa? I would like to go back to Her Excellency Dr. Fatou Majo. You know, we have done a lot of efforts to provide quota systems, whether at the political level or at the business level. In your opinion, isn't it a time to go beyond quota system? If you're going to give us a recommendation from your experience, what other innovative measures that we should do to promote gender equality beyond the quota system?
I don't believe in the quota system. At the level of the state. When I say the state, because when you have the quota system, it's going to be legislated in the parliament, and it's a bill and then enacted as a law. I have had Brown here, which I agree with. We must go for it as women. And the pink wave has to be taken, we have to ask for it now. So what I believe in is to make sure that we put it, or we start from the political parties. Because if we don't start from the political parties, at the level of the state, there is quota system, there is this begging platform, recommendation, action plans, which are saying 35%. But how many governments in Africa or in the whole world that is going in line with the Benin platform of action of 35%. Nobody. It's only Rwanda. And possibly sometimes, I think it's Zimbabwe, Senegal went to it during Abdoulaye Wade's time, but then retracted. In my parliament, there was a time, a parliament of members of 40 to 42. We only had 7 women, and then by the midterm of the parliament, the executive has sacked all the women that they are nominated because they didn't run for election. So that's why also it's very important for yesterday's discussion that parliaments have to be very independent from the executive, because as rubber stamp, we cannot do anything. Because if they bring their own bills, they want things to go action like roads to be done and money's loads to be, they bring in, the Minister of Finance comes in, the Minister of Justice comes, and then it's passed. But when it comes to things that is related to us and the grassroots, the executive will say no, and then that's where we are called rubber stamp. So coming back to the women aspect of quota, I think we must start, and I think we will believe this, we will accept this. The political parties must be incorporating in their constitutions that the quota should start from there. If in the political parties that they all over the cross the board that they say, like in, you know, the French system, I don't know whether you understand the French, you must be, because you are neighbors Benin and Togo and Burkina Faso, we are in Senegal, Gambia. They have the proportional system of voting, where if the list is 21, if the number one is a male, number two will be a female. And that's how this goes on. So if you are there 21 or 20, you will be having 10 women, 10 men. So we don't have that. We go in our Commonwealth parliamentary system and Republican system. We go by first past the post. So when we make sure that democracy is sustained and poverty alleviation is also to be eradicated, we must start with the political parties with the quotas. Let the political parties make sure that even in the executive, if these 10, 5 are women and 5 are men, then there is decision making. So because if we just want to take it at the level of parliament, they will say yes, but they will not. They will not.
Okay.
So the quota system is good, but it's not helping. The political parties have to be strengthened to make sure that they accept the gender aspect and the gender fight to make sure that women are decision makers at the level
of
the national parties.
Thank you for your insights. Your Excellency Princess Filomena, women empowerment, especially women economic empowerment, need access to finance, access to funding. What recommendation from your experience you could tell us with the perspective of reforming the banking system to provide more access to women to credit and financing?
Access to credit as well for loans. When it comes to loans in Africa, especially in Nigeria, in the United States that I know, loan rate is 2 to 5%. Here it's from 20 to 30%. No women can pay that. And they need education. Education is the key. Even to tell them how to write a business plan, how to pay back, what kind of business they're going to do. And to help women, one, men are more aggressive than us. Although we are larger in population. In Africa, women 54%, men 46%. So we should be the drivers, because we're more in population. And now we have more educated women. But because of cultural constraints and domestic violence and all of things, girl child education, we are still behind. I would suggest, that's my own suggestion, for we to have programs, I will call it quota, but programs that can make us reach up to that, like women cooperatives, starting a women banking, like the Hassel residence, Mrs. Maria Shopping, went to the People's Bank. It was possible for me. I don't know why that bank died. To have empowered them more. We create corporate industries and small businesses. I remember many years ago when I was consulting for Federation of Indian Women Entrepreneurs, I took, because then in those countries they taught African women businesses, what we do is only sell, you know, and this and that. I remember when they did the Business Women Network Conference in the United States, I consulted for them. I told them that I can help bring top business women from Africa that will sit on the table, eyeball to eyeball, and discuss and negotiate, which we were able to do. When I went to Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, I saw what women were doing in small cottage industries. My head was so I said, we in ECOWAS and Nigeria especially, we can do that. Every Indian woman at her backyard has a small cottage industry. And the what they produce is of export quality. And what they use is raw material from India. Why can't we do that?
To some of the traditional rulers in this area, to sit down with them and tell them the world is moving forward. Africa is still lagging behind due to some of this tradition that restrict women from doing certain things. I'm sure we'll be able to make progress. Women are strong, and until everyone sees that, it is the same way we talk about strength. We're talking about the strength of a man and talking about the strength of a woman. I'm sure we'll be able to get the women to get the approval that is needed for women to achieve, to be able to do what it is they have in mind that they want to do. Restriction, tradition, culture is a big barrier. That's what I see. And if we're able to overcome some of these cultures that hinder women from coming out to do what they want to do, I'm sure we'll get a lot of them participating in the areas we expect them to participate.
Thank you so much. Mrs. Ndeshi, from your experience, if I ask you to give us one important experience of female entrepreneurship that inspired you, that you could share with the audience, what would that be?
Age-long cultural impediments that have negatively affected the empowerment of women.
And it is something that the traditional institution, with the proposals I consult on, I have made to them, is something that they should bring to the front burner. How are they going to discuss on making sure that cultural barriers are near possibly erased in terms of the empowerment of women? In the agri policies that you have, women, like one of the speakers here said, women don't have financial inclusion. They do not have access to what is called collateral for a great majority of them. So these are barriers that have to be broken. In some cultural settings, when they allocate land to families, women are not included. That's a cultural bias. When they allocate, probably, let's say an institution intends to recruit from a community, and the request is sent to the traditional school in that community, women's names that have the requisite qualification, they are not included. So tell me, how is it possible for you to empower the woman? It's not by giving her some soft loans and all that, no. In fact, Nancy, this Africa Economic Congress Forum should be an avenue where we can begin to think of a women development bank. The reason behind this is because it should be a discourse that should go beyond this Congress, where you're going to have near zero interest on facilities that can be afforded to women. Because the ventures women can go into, a great proportion of men cannot go into them. That's the fact. Men may probably want to do it in a mechanized way, but women could probably be doing it in the normal physical way, but at the same time, they have the way of balancing the equation and ensuring that there is commercial value and that there's profit oriented in what they're doing. So to me, I think that the traditional institution in Africa, generally, that's where the matter is.
In the media, we really do need to do a lot, because we're talking about Africa, the responsibility of also shaping the African narrative in all the sectors also lies with the media. It depends on what we put out, people consume what we put out, whether it's positive or negative. I think for us also in the media, we need to engender and talk more a bit about issues that perhaps even affect us as women, talking about gender equality. Sometimes, I really do not want to toe the line that perhaps, you know, women are fragile, women are not too strong, and all of that. I really do not want to toe the line. And as a parting shot, even as we leave this session, especially to young women, young girls that are coming up, aim for the skies, aim, break the glass ceilings. All you need to do is to try. I think someone sang it, either Get Rich or Die Trying or something. You really just need to try. Because if you take a look at it, even in the economic space, a lot of women go for loans. Women are not defaulters. Women pay back money than men. But how do you explain that, you know, you see a lot of women, a lot of female women in the boardrooms? For example, in Africa, you don't see a lot of women in the boardrooms. Not just even in Africa, even in America, it's like that. You see a lot of women in lower spaces. You don't see women that are chief executive officers. Then if you see a woman and a man doing the same job, the man is paid higher. Why is it that way? So I think it's also a responsibility on our part as women to say, I don't want to say take it by force, but you need to prove yourself. Whenever you're also given the opportunity, prove yourself that you can do it, and leave it for the judges to say if you do it better than the men.
Thank you so much. Unfortunately, we cannot take questions because we are behind schedule. Thank you all for this distinguished panel. Please give them a round of applause.